I'm Nick. I live in Brooklyn now. I've got four kids, but I'm from Newport Beach on the Inchina Peninsula, and here's proof. I'm the one on the left there, and I'm the one who looks like he needs to go to the dunny. And as you can see, I grew up in a very diverse neighborhood. There are people with dark hair and light hair. And I am the minority because I have red hair. I also, whenever I look at this, I'm reminded why we all have melanomas and we look like we're 50 when we're 20. Look, every single child there is squinting. Anyway, so I just got this fancy new job, as Martin said. This is the title. It's a long title, President of Publicis Communications and Creative Officer of Publicis Groupe. And as Martin said, it's a very old and large French advertising holding company. I've been hired to help change it. It's 80,000 people all over the world. This is what's been going on in the advertising industry. This is stock prices. Publicis is the mid-gray. Oh, it doesn't matter. They're all in the shit. But anyway, so this is where we are right now, and there are reasons for this. And curiously, as I came aboard and sort of surveyed this new company and saw all the pieces, and there's a variety of different companies, Saatchi & Saatchi, Leo Burnett, which are more classic advertising agencies. Then they have more digital transformation companies like Sapient and Razorfish and everything in between, large media practice. What I realized is that they are uniquely unqualified to change. And the reason is that they've added value for the last 100 years to their clients by telling stories, because they existed in an industry that was very stable, right? So you had a very stable sort of economic situation where you had a media environment which was made up of very stable templates that didn't change. And so the value that these advertising companies give their clients was telling a story about their business. So it's just the top bit. And as you all know, with the advent of this thing called the internet, everything changed. There's this complete chaos as a result of the sort of connected world has disrupted almost every industry. And so not only are their clients in need of more than just storytelling, but the industry itself needs to redesign themselves, right? And this is why I've realized that my job is not just to be the head of the sort of the creatives in this company, but it's also to help them change using design. Because as I said, they've spent the last 50 years changing their clients' business by telling stories. And right now, that's not going to be enough. And I'll get into more detail on why. They're two very different ways of thinking. So this is what I'm going to go through. I'm going to talk about my early career in design and the influence the web had on me. I'm going to talk about how that made me rethink how you should think about creative capabilities and creative aptitudes, how that led me to then start to redesign the teams in the companies that I was working. And then, of course, this need to create new capabilities given the new environment. So let me start with... So I went to a learning institution just down the road in 1985, Ramick Technical College. I have a certificate of design. It took 2 years to get. I learned how to use a T-square. And as you can see, I mean, I don't, you guys are probably jealous of this place because you've got... Hang on. It's got a nice view of Ramick Racecourse, and it's a block walk from the National Drug and Alcohol Research Center. And you think you've got a nice campus. Right next. I left Ramick Tech with this certificate that no one has ever asked to see. I worked in design, a small corporate identity company in Australia, for about 18 months before I then moved to London. And I worked at a design company called Pentagram in London for a while under a guy called Alan Fletcher and John McConnell. And then I went into this nasty world of advertising. All my design friends thought I'd completely sold out. All of a sudden, I was getting paid more money and using less craft. And then I moved to New York in 1994, and towards the late 90s, got involved with the startup scene, so the first bubble. And it was then called interactive design, and so I started to learn how to design web pages, because that's what it was then. And the sort of interesting thing in that journey is that this was before the internet. Early interactive wasn't really connected, it was just an interface. And each of these design disciplines that I was involved with had a very discrete and siloed culture. They weren't connected. What was considered an idea or a concept, it was very different from design to advertising to that early interactive world. And so what I noticed in my next job, right, in 2001, when I joined this company, RGA, this lovely Bauhausian building is on 39th Street in the Hell's Kitchen. And what I witnessed while I was there for the 17 years was the web basically eating the world and connecting all the things that I'd done in the past into this big sort of big mash. A very influential client early on was Nike. And Nike was part of this process of us chasing the web as the capabilities rushed way ahead of the practice. I don't know if you were, how many of you are in experience design or interactive design, but in 1999, there was a book that came out by a guy called Jacob Nielsen, which was called, I think, Web Usability. And there were certain conventions around how you designed a website at that point. You know, left-hand navs, hyperlinked, blue type. And what we did in these early days, because it's very experimental, was that a year after that book came out, we completely broke every rule. And this was a very unusual time. I think the web was an unusual medium because as soon as something had been established, it was broken and twisted, right? The web is not as dynamic now as it was then. It was crazy. So the first teams that we put together in the early web design work that we did with Nike looked like this. We had interaction design, visual design, a technologist, and a copywriter. And we made things that looked like this. So this was already way ahead of those early hyperlinked brochure websites. We had, you know, animations with the navigation. Most of it was built in Flash. But it was essentially a brochure, a very sexy animated brochure. But the web started, the pipe started to get bigger and the things you could do in the web became more profound. And we went from, you know, delivering information for Nike to actually helping people customize shoes. There we were in New York at RGA. And in the middle of this accelerating medium called the web. So it went from information, delivering information, to delivering utility. So we designed this site called Nike ID, which affected Nike's supply chain because, you know, we were designing in real-time shoes. People were sending them in. It was their biggest e-commerce engine for the longest time. And then we did this thing called Nike Plus, right? It was really, in retrospect, the first mass Internet of Things product. It was a sensor that you put in your shoe, which spoke to a nano and tracked your running. You could share that running with the community. And it was a big breakthrough for Nike because it meant that they went from being a shoe and apparel company to a product and services company. And this is something that we've seen since sort of repeated throughout business, which is this service layer that gets built on top of companies because of the web. And then in 2012, we created a product which was hugely successful, and it started the whole trend of the quantified self movement. So this is the first case study, and I can sit down and have a nap while you watch this.
7 years ago, with the launch of Nike Plus, Nike started a journey that has taken them from being a company that makes shoes and apparel to a products and services company. This year, with the launch of Nike Plus Fuel Band, a metric that measures all activity called Nike Fuel ties all these products and services together into a connected ecosystem. Nike Fuel is the only standard that lets you compare yourself with anyone else, no matter who they are or what they're doing. Nike Fuel Band is the device you wear that tracks everything you do. The LED lights change from red to yellow, and when you hit your goal, green. When you buy a Fuel Band, you automatically become part of the Nike Plus community.
We've built it to be a motivational game. It's that competition that keeps you coming back. Getting to your goal every day is the core part of the experience.
When you know how active you are, you can change the way you behave and improve on your goals.
And when it came time to launch the product, we came up with one word that summarized it all: counts.
Everything you do counts. That became the basis for the campaign introducing Nike Fuel to the world. Creating products and services that become a part of people's everyday lives is the commitment we've seen evolve over 2 years of collaborating with Nike on the Fuel experience. From the Fuel metric itself, to the mobile and platform integration, to social engagements, and ultimately the launch of the Fuel Band.
Nike has this saying, if you have a body, you are an athlete, and now this is finally coming true.
So at this point, as practitioners of the medium called the web, we were convinced that advertising was sort of going to disappear because utility was going to replace it. What we didn't realize was that the web was going to eat everything. It wasn't just going to be a place for information, for functionality, for utility, for transaction. It was also going to be a place where people actually enjoy the things that they're enjoying on other devices. So as people that worked on the web, we had to get good at doing this other thing that the traditional advertising agencies had been doing for years, which is tell stories, right? And so the client that we cut our teeth on storytelling, we won in 2014, and it was Beats by Dre. And when we started work with them, they were a small startup. They didn't have a big budget. So we did a lot of guerrilla work. And it was the first time we introduced into our creative team this classic art director copywriter team, right, which is the advertising team. And we started immediately to do some pretty interesting work. I'm going to show you something we did for them, not last World Cup, but the World Cup before.
Alô, oi filho, tudo bem?
E aí, cabeça?
Tá feliz? Tá feliz, né?
Tô. Claro que tô.
Hoje é um dia importante, como sempre foi na nossa vida. Então, hoje, corra. Corra como se fosse o último dia da sua vida.
Vai pra direita, pra esquerda, vamos.
Corra como fosse um cara louco atrás da felicidade. Corra pela sua família, pros seus amigos. Seja feliz hoje, brinque de futebol.
Vem, mano!
Tá ok? Tá bom?
Ali, essa do meio, essa aí mesmo, mexe!
Vem, mano!
É, mas tem uma coisa.
Vem, mano!
É importante que você não se poupe.
Like it's there.
exército de Deus na frente. Se reveste toda a armadura de Deus possível, desde o capacete até a sandália. Vai com Deus, Deus te abençoe muito. Te amo, tá?
So we went from designing web pages and interfaces and apps to doing storytelling. And it was a big surprise for the industry because we had been seen as this bunch of nerds that were very technical and we had crippling Asperger's. We would turn up to Cannes and wouldn't look at anyone in the face. And then all of a sudden we turn up to Cannes and we were winning Gold Lions with this. And there was something about the way we were doing this storytelling, which is sort of qualitatively very different to the traditional agencies. And it was because our team now looked like this. So we had the sort of classic interface design team, and then we added the copywriter and art director. And what happened was, the copywriter and art directors, as soon as they started to join these teams, they started to think very differently about their craft. And this goes back to the influence of design. So our storytelling started on the web. It didn't start in broadcast. Our competitors, the traditional agencies, they started in broadcast. And they then tried to figure out how to cut down their ads and put them on the web. We started on the web, which is why that was long form. And the important influence that design had over that was that if you're an interaction designer, if you're designing interfaces, there's a principle that you learn very quickly, and that is you think about the user first. It's always user first, because when you're designing software, you can't buy usage. It's not like advertising where you buy media and you interrupt people. You don't have to ask why someone is looking at your ad. The reason is because they're watching a bloody footy, right? And you interrupted them. But if you start asking why they might be looking at a piece of narrative like that, and if you think about them as a user as opposed to just someone you're interrupting, then it changes how you look at a narrative. So we started to think about the audience first, and we started to ask questions about what's the story that the audience would want to tell? Because if they want to tell this story, when they see it on their stream, they're going to share it, and then we're going to get these magnificent network effects. So we went on this run of doing a whole bunch of narrative work. It started with that. We ended up doing a film for the Ad Council in the US called Love Has No Labels. So you might know it, Dancing Skeletons. Got 200 million views. And it was like out of the blue, largely because of the influence of experience design. We started to think about narrative living in an interface, and then we started to ask different questions. What is the audience going to do with it, not where the audience is just going to see it. And so with this team, we started to tell different stories, but we also combined things. So we started to look at not just designing interfaces and software, but then once we'd done that, telling stories about that, which was the inversion of what the traditional agencies were doing, because they were telling stories and then figuring out how to push it down into digital media. We were creating digital products and then putting stories on top of them. So here's an example of something we did for Beats, which was their Beats music product, which was in the end the reason that Apple bought them and got paid billions and we got none of it. But anyway, here we go.
What if you had the perfect music for every moment? Kisses would be deeper, drives faster, inspiration would flow, and life would be infused with magic. And to do that, you'll need more inside your skull than a circuit board. Because code can't hear the Bowie in a band's influences. It doesn't know why the Stones segue perfectly into Aretha Franklin. You'd want brains and souls. Created an elegant, fun solution that integrates the best technology with friendly, trustworthy humanity. It understands music as emotion and joy, culture, and life. The music is much more than just digital files. It breathes and bleeds and feels. only thing as important as the song you're hearing now is the song that comes next. Music and the next step in the evolution that's taken us from 45s to CDs to streaming. But the most important thing about it is that you'll be blown away by what happens when you hit play. The right music, like magic.
So that was a huge effort to build this application and then to do a Super Bowl spot. And it required this spectrum of capabilities from storytelling to design. You could take the same team and do something that is really simple. So the next thing I'm going to show you cost $100,000, but was hugely successful and almost as effective as that product.
In the summer of 2015, Universal Pictures partnered with Beats by Dre to promote Straight Outta Compton, the biopic movie of the headphone company's founding father and billionaire rap mogul, Dr. Dre, growing up in one of the most notorious neighborhoods in the world.
Tell him where you're from. Straight Outta Compton.
What Beats realized is this isn't just about Compton. Everyone is proud of where they're from. So we launched an integrated campaign that celebrated every city in the world, because we're all straight out of somewhere. Hashtag Straight Outta became a universal statement for everyone to rep their city. People could create their own custom memes to rep their own hometowns by simply typing in their city name and uploading an image. Across the world, people created their own hashtag Straight Outta memes. The world's biggest celebrities joined in without receiving any endorsement money from Beats.
You are straight out of upstate New York.
That's right, yeah.
In less than 24 hours, it became the number one trending topic on Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook. No other brand in history has ever achieved this.
That shit was dope, man.
The world took over, and no one or nothing was safe. Other brands couldn't ignore the campaign's success and got involved. Even the United Nations harnessed the campaign's power for good. Then what happened next surprised us all. President Obama created his very own hashtag Straight Outta Meme.
Instead of using the word straight out of Compton, the White House tweeted, Iran would be, quote, straight out of uranium.
In the end, it not only became Beats' biggest campaign ever, but the biggest social campaign of 2015.
So we had this broad team, and while this was going on and while we were doing all this different work and connecting it, we were rethinking creativity and the organizing principle around it, right? But meanwhile, back in the advertising world, which we were sort of running parallel to, the world which incidentally I'm now a part of, they were still just had this team. That was the team they had, right? This was the atomic team for advertising. A lot of it was to do with the fact that, as I said, I think in the break, their medium had become so stagnant, these templates of TV, print, that they didn't have to rethink or redesign their team. And this team had been around since the 1950s. In the 1950s, when there were really three media channels that you could do advertising on. There was print, radio, and TV. And the creative team was a writer, right? The writer was a creative team, and downstairs there was this art director coloring in the ads that the writer came up with. And so ads looked like this. They were very, very editorial. They were very descriptive. They were basically illustrated pamphlets. And then this guy called Bill Birnbach came along in the late 50s and had this idea. And what's interesting about what Bill Birnbach did was that this was the last time that someone thought about how to design a team. right? Because what he did was, he did this amazing innovation. He brought the art director up from downstairs and paired them with the copywriter. And so you got the Atomic Team. This is what spawned the creative revolution and the Mad Men era. And the ads that came out of that were sort of sublime. There was this wonderful work that came out of a Birnbach's agency like this, the VW work. And if you look at this print ad, it's beautiful. And the thing that you notice about it is that the copy and the art are so enmeshed, you can't take one away from the other. If you took away the picture, the ad doesn't work. If you take the copy away, it doesn't work. There's this symbiosis, right, because of this invention this guy came up with, which is we're going to put these two together. And so this was a formula, and it still is a formula for most traditional advertising companies. You've got art and copy, and between them, they create this story, this intriguing story with an interesting tension and symbiosis between these two things. So what we had developed in parallel with what you just saw is that we took the story, right? And instead of adding it with anything, what we did is that we combined story and design. So we took that Atomic Team of art director, copywriter, and we put them in a specific role, and then we overlapped it with design. And this was important, right, because what we were creating wasn't just stories, we were creating all sorts of experiences, right? An experience, by definition, is something that you can interact with, right? So it could be behind an interface, it could be something digital in the physical world, but it was something richer and more dimensional than just a story being pushed down into the world. So we had created this sort of universe of work based on the overlap of these of story and design. And why that was very different to what the agencies were doing is that their starting point was with the Atomic Team, art and copy. They came up with a story and they pushed it down into the world. We inverted that, and we designed an experience, and we designed a behavior with an interface, right? And then we created a story about it. So we had the sort of a bottom-up process. They were top-down, we inverted, we were bottom-up. And we could do that because very early on, I recognized, right, that that there were very different ways of thinking creatively. In the advertising world, creativity is synonymous with storytelling. Anyone that was practitioner of the web, anyone who was a designer was considered executional, and they came after the idea was hatched by a storytelling team, right? What they didn't recognize was that there are very different ways of thinking creatively. And so early on when we started to do narrative work, and I got creatives that had been designing interfaces for 10 years to start doing storytelling, they were really shit at it. They couldn't do it. That's not how they thought. And I saw over in the traditional agencies, these art director copywriter teams trying to design apps and work in new media, and they couldn't do that. And it occurred to me that there were these two ways of thinking. And so we started to organize our creative teams around this principle, this organizing principle of what I called stories and systems, which because this is a conference about design, I'm saying story and design. It's the same thing, right? And I represent this as a brain for two reasons. First of all, because it's sort of a metaphor for the brain, the creative brain of the company, that they're two hemispheres that are lateralized and working together, and they're two very different ways of thinking. But I also represent it like this because there is some truth in this, right? Because one side of the brain is a temporal processor, and the other side of the brain is a spatial processor. I don't know if you've ever seen that TED talk by this neuroscientist called Bolte. What's her name? I can't remember her name. But she's a neuroscientist that gets an aneurysm in one of the hemispheres of her brain, and so while that hemisphere is being degraded, she knows what's going on. And in her case, I think it was the right hemisphere, and so it was the left hemisphere. She lost all sense of time, and all she could do was grasp space. It's very interesting, but there is some that I'm not a scientist. I'm an amateur, right? I don't have a degree. I do have a certificate from Ramuk Tech, by the way. Does anyone want to see it? So there is some truth to this, and it stands to reason that because being creative, it's a craft. If you spend 10 years you get good at something. It's a Gladwellian principle. 10,000 hours makes you good at something. And so if you've spent 10 years figuring out how to tell stories, it stands to reason that the temporal side of your brain is going to have paths that are deeper. And if you're a designer and you look at things sort of architecturally and you look at the relationship between things, then probably the right-hand side of your brain is going to be more developed. So this was a sort of the organizing principle. It's a sort of different way of processing creatively. You either process things one at a time or you process things all at once, right? It's either spatial or it's temporal. And what I found was I could judge how well I had matched the team, the designers and the storytellers, based on the tension between these two things. Because narrative thinkers are subtractive thinkers. Their skill is about the revealed moment. It's about that one moment, one after another, and the effectiveness of that moment to surprise you the next moment. It's subtractive, right? Design thinkers, systematic thinkers, are additive thinkers. They see everything at once and they connect them. One definition of innovation is taking two existing ways of thinking and connecting them to make a new way of thinking, right? And that's what designers are particularly good at. So they represent possibility. So getting this balance between simplicity and possibility was what I tried every time I opened an office. So we had 17 offices around the world. Each of them had these two ways of thinking represented. If the office was telling great brand stories but not innovating, I had too many storytellers, right? If they were innovating but they couldn't tell a coherent story and a simple story about what they were innovating, it meant there was too many experience designers or too many systematic thinkers. So this became the organizing principle. And it started to influence everything. So I began to design the teams around this. So if you go back to the Burnback team of art and copy, coming up with stories, and I now at Publicis, I go in these traditional agencies and I see how they're structured. They're structured like this. They've got an executive creative director who is probably a storyteller of some description, art director, copywriter, who is leading a team of art director, copywriters, right? These married teams. So this is a Burnback team, designed in the late 50s. And then as these new capabilities pop up, you know, data, experience design, social, technology, media, they array them underneath. And there's a huge flaw with this design, because it's dependent on the art director copywriters curating what skill sets they need. So the art director copywriters aren't qualified to know what a good experience designer is or know when to bring in the data person. And this is the flaw, and this is why I come into Publicis and I see these agencies. I need to redesign them. It's not enough to bring in people and hope that it's going to work. I need to redesign them. And if I'm going to redesign around this principle of stories and designs, creating experiences, then it looks like this, which is what I did at RGA. You sometimes have an EC at the top, sometimes you don't. Sometimes the leaders of an office are just the stories and design pairs. So you've got a narrative thinker and a design thinker. And this organizing principle is all you need. You don't need teams underneath it, because what they're responsible for, because they're broadly literate across all these ways of creative thinking, they're responsible for then curating a team, whatever the problem that needs to be solved. So they're not limited by filtering things through art director copywriter team. If they have a client that needs some sort of business transformation, they'll get a very different team than if they have a client that needs to build a brand. So you can create all sorts of exotic teams underneath that, curated by that team working on top. So the web, as if you go back to where I started, the web was very good at getting this muscle for creating capabilities, because the web changed all the time. It was always changing. My cousins over in the traditional advertising, they didn't change. They were in the same. So this ability to change capabilities became very important to how we worked. And so there's this few principles to think about when it comes to changing. One is that if you look at a company as a pyramid, the thing that it sits on top of is a structure. And what I mean by that is, where are people sitting and what are they doing, right? That's a structure. On top, you've got people, right? You stick people on top of a structure. And then the interplay between those two things is process. It's very important, right, that you start at the bottom and you change from the bottom up. A lot of the agencies tried by hiring new people. If you hire a smart digital person and you stick them on top of the wrong structure, they're going to fail. Their ambitions aren't going to be satisfied. If you obsess about process, you're going to fail because you're not letting people think. Get the structure right, put people on top, and they'll figure out the process. So that's one thing. If you're going to start changing things, you start from the structure, not from the people. And then you've got to understand that when you introduce new capabilities, it's difficult. You always start poorly. There was never an instance when we added a capability to RGA, whether it be storytelling or brand design or AI, our accelerator. We keep adding these horizontal capabilities. Every time we go through these three generations, the first generation is we get it wrong. We get the wrong people and we don't know what we're doing. We know strategically that we need to do this, but we end up faking it. And you've got to be patient enough to get to the next stage, which is you get competent. So when we got competent at storytelling, we were as good as an average agency. We were no better. And generally we do this by incubating it off to the side. And the only reason we ever open a capability and go through this pain, which could take a few years, is because we want to get to this third stage, which is we want to reinvent it. And the way you reinvent it is once you have a capability that is as good as everyone else, you then connect it with your other capabilities, and that always inverts it and turns it into something else. What I was talking about, storytelling, we incubated storytelling teams until they were as good as an average agency. Then we connected them to the larger team, and the experienced designers that they worked with changed the way they told stories. So that's a reinvention bit. So you incubate it, you get good, and then you connect it and you reinvent it. And what's interesting about all this and why this is so important and why my new job, I'm going to be required to do this, is that these inventions that are happening in media and in communications and products and services are happening so rapidly now. As an experienced designer, it's not enough to be able to sketch wireframes now. You have to think about voice interfaces, conversational interfaces, AI, VR, AR, there's all sorts of burgeoning capabilities you need to become good at. And what I'm going to have to do is get a lot of these agencies to start creating these capabilities far more rapidly than they are because they're stuck in this burn back team. And the way to do that goes back to this framework. So this framework is strangely, because I think it's so primal, because it matches the hemispheres of the brain, I think it works. So if you think about how to do VR, for example, VR is, the definition is doing these two things, because unlike classic storytelling, filmic storytelling, which is about the revealed moment, VR is about the revealed space. And so you need a storyteller and someone who understands space, a designer, someone that thinks architecturally. Same thing with conversational interfaces. Designing a sort of conversation tree for a conversation interface It's a systematic task. Get in the tone of the copyright, making sure it sounds human and that it's responsive and warm. That's classic storytelling. So all of these new emergent technologies can be handled by this framework, which comes from the fact that I'm a bloody designer, right? Not because I'm some storyteller or some ad wanker. It's because I'm a designer. And this is why design is eating the world. And I'm ready to have a gin and tonic.
I was just wondering, you're moving into, you know, more of a traditional advertising agency, and the thing that really struck me was where you sort of talk about we've bought a way to interrupt you, but I guess the way that we're starting to consume content now is that we're buying Spotify Premium, we've got Netflix, we've got all these things that we're consuming content that are controlling the ability for brands to interrupt. Yeah. I wonder if you could had any thoughts about in the future, you know, how to get around these kinds of things for that kind of industry.
Well, I think that's why the stock price graph that I showed you was going down.
Yeah.
We've gone from a world where media manipulated people to where people are manipulating media. And as soon as the interface was put in front of our media, then we had the ability to skid it. Now, sometimes we're prepared to pay an advertising tax to get free services. So with Google and Facebook's success is to do with the fact that they've made the entry point into those platforms free, completely free. And the only way they can do that is by delivering ads. Now, if they had a subscription service, which I think Facebook is thinking about because of the problems, all of a sudden, the only people that are going to get a to sign up for a subscription service so that they don't get ads, right, which is like the Spotify premium model, are those people that have got the money. And they're the people that the advertisers want to reach. So there's this big conundrum right now, right, which is that there is something sort of glorious about what advertising is able to do to democratize this technology so people have access to amazing tools, especially with the stuff that Google gives you. But I think people sort of know, even subconsciously, that they only get that because they're getting served ads and they're prepared to put up with it. So we're going. So people are going to be less prepared to put up with broadcast interruptions and more prepared to put up with interruptions through an interface, right? Because they're getting another. They're getting a different value. The value that I get from, you know, from an ad stopping me from watching the Rabbitohs beat the Storms tomorrow, which they will do by 20 points, I reckon. But the value of that is I get zero value from that. It just annoys me, right? All the value of that goes to the advertiser and to the broadcaster. If I'm interrupted by an ad on Instagram, the value that I get is I get Instagram for free. So I'm getting a value there. So that's why this the old model is failing, because it doesn't satisfy, the value doesn't come towards the consumer. I don't know if that's a tortured and complicated way to answer your question, but there you go. I've got jet lag.
We have a couple of questions down here. One there and
Well, I have this general question. Martin's a student in interaction designs first semester, so I'm in the beginning of the way. I wanted to know that what is your advice to become someone like you? I should go for the internships, I should go working in different countries. What's the first steps to become someone as good as you?
Well, I mean, my career is so well designed. I got on a plane, a one-way ticket to Bangkok, and I didn't find my way home. I think I was chasing women. I was hugely unsuccessful. I got lots of intestinal diseases. But now, I mean, I think just, I mean, the main thing is to commit to a craft. That's it. I mean, to me, that's the thing. I mean, I joke about the fact that I have no degree. I was raised by wolves. You know, but. No, but there is something about just getting out in the world and working. Wherever as an experience designer, you could argue that the best place for that is the West Coast of America, but there are probably plenty of product companies and services here. The thing is that one thing I will say is that if I was starting now, I would choose experience design. And the reason I'd choose experience design is because it's the most vital design discipline because it changes constantly. Experience design went from designing wireframes in InDesign, and now we're trying to figure out gestural interfaces, audio interfaces. It's going to keep changing, and to me that's really interesting. You'll never not have a job if you're an experience designer and you're curious. So I'm assuming you're curious. So I would just do whatever you feel like doing. Go to the good places. Never go to the bad places. Don't just take a job because they give you a job. Always insist on going to the best place. And then build your craft. You know, you'll get good over time. It won't be straight away. But you're in a good place with experience design, that's for sure.
Steve, there's a question just here. While you're getting there, I have a question for you, Nick. You mentioned, Straight Outta Compton is one of the best campaigns I've ever seen. It still works, by the way. We're just trading some Straight Outta Comptons here about you at the moment, which is great, so have a look later. But you mentioned that the key there was creating a narrative that said more about the audience than it did about the brand.
Yeah.
And that's really what made that take off. Is that between design and story, or is that some other skill, or is that something to do with psychology or understanding people? Where did that come from, and how do you bring that skill set into things?
I think there are two parts of that. One is that the quality of your storytelling needs to be different. So classic advertising is, I've got something to say about my product, and I'm going to push it down into the world. I'll do it in an interesting way so you won't get too bored, but I'm going to push it down into the world because I need to tell you that. Now, the narrative stuff that we develop, we started with what are people thinking about now? What are they already sharing? So with the World Cup campaign, all of those rituals that those soccer players were doing were real. They were real rituals. We did our research because we knew that once it was online, people would be interested in that, and they'd find out about it, and they go down these little rabbit holes. What doesn't work so well online are these big bloated metaphors, which is classic. It's the trope of advertising in the 80s was big metaphors, right? Make you feel something about a product that you don't quite know by using something else. And what we found is that stuff doesn't work on the web, right? The stuff that works on the web is stuff that they're already asking themselves, they're already thinking about, and then what you get then, which is the second part, which is, so if you're influenced by this sort of design ethic of thinking about the user first, you're going to tell a different story. But then how that story lives on the internet is understanding systems, understanding network effects, feedback loops, all those things that designers understand, these sort of dimensional thing. You put this object, when we did the Love Has No Labels dancing skeleton film for the Ad Council, we seeded it on Upworthy, which was a community of people that care about social causes, because we knew we would get some network effects from that. We knew that they would share. We knew they cared about that. So you think about the quality of the narrative being influenced by design, but then you think about how that narrative lives in a system as a designer, how it behaves, where it goes, how you create these sort of systematic effects.
Thank you. Have you got the mic there? Great.
Yeah, thank you for that. So my question goes back to the title of your presentation, which has the word change in it.
Yeah.
So I'm just interested in knowing what is change for you and how far-reaching do you think change? Because, and I'm intentionally being provocative here.
Yeah.
For me, like if I think change, I think putting people first, putting sustainable futures first. Mm-hmm. And in that framework, anyone who talks about, in conjunction with change about products and customers, discredits themselves. Mm-hmm. What do you think about that? It's intentionally provocative,
No. So I think that one of the things that the web has created is a certain transparency and responsibility. So almost every one of our clients now have some sort of corporate responsibility mission. Some of them do it better than others. But a huge part of their marketing budgets are now cause-related, and so they're doing stuff. Now, and change, the reason that change has accelerated so rapidly since the advent of the internet is because of network effects. So you have this sort of hockey stick graph of change in every medium. Or every industry. It started with music because it was the tiniest file, and people could share it, and that completely disrupted the music industry, made it shrink by a third, and now it's sort of rebuilt itself. It's the same thing happening in media. The same thing is going to happen in education. The education industry or is going to be completely. It's hanging on. There's some legacy leverage there, but it's going to really be disrupted. And the other thing that's been disrupted is the ability for people to find out what companies are doing. What's happened with big automotive companies that have, you know, the whole Dieselgate scandal, all of this stuff comes out now. And so the big change that I've found in the 30 years that I've been working, companies never talked about that stuff before. There's also a huge ability to do bad things, right? And we saw what happened with the St. Petersburg cell in the American election. So, but this is a sort of balancing thing. I agree with you. But you also got to remember that these companies, these big benefactors that do things that are important, like the Gates Foundation. Bill Gates Foundation is enormous and does amazing things all over the world. But the way they can do that is because they're very wealthy. They're very wealthy because they had a great business and created a lot of wealth, and now he's using that wealth. So I think you've got to have both. you've got to be able to create wealth and then distribute it and be responsible with it. And I think the change that has been triggered by the web has made that both easier, but also it's balanced, right? I mean, during the the revolution that happened in the Middle East around social media. We all thought that social media was going to be this amazing thing that was going to topple corrupt government. And now we've seen that it's actually doing the opposite. So it's a two-edged sword. I think it's very ambiguous. But I agree that we should be asking these questions. We should be very skeptical.
We've probably got time for one final question, which we have down here. Can you get down here? All right, it's a race. This will be our last question. It is a really tough one because it's about authenticity. I think that the question of claiming change.
Yeah.
It is a loaded gun, really. Yeah.
Thanks, and I'd like to kind of riff off what you just asked. So, as experienced designers now, we're not just playing with brands, and we're not just creating stories. We're also designing government services. We're designing health equipment that has life and death consequences as to how well or poorly we do interfaces. Recently, Mike Montero went on a fabulous rant about ethics and design. And given that we have these responsibilities now as designers, and his suggestion is that we should all be licensed like doctors and dentists and things. So I'm interested in how you would respond to that sort of progression in our industry. Is it something that actually does need licensing and legislation? Because we have a lot of power and responsibility in the work that we do.
No, I don't think so. I mean, I agree, but I also think that the innovation that happens right now is this sort of flywheel, thanks to the democracy of the. I don't know if you could license it. You can't stop that. If the web remains free and open, which I think it should, because I think that's it. I think it's a safeguard against democracy. Then it's going to be very hard to license it. But I think licensing tends to be rent-seeking by those that are practicing, and a barrier to those that want to practice. I think every creative, because I think experience design is creative, every creative discipline becomes richer and better the more people that are doing it. I think that's just a fact. Now, I do think also that some of the principles of experience design that are happening in the private world should be applied to the government world, because typically I think in my experience, the stuff that you experience in the government, websites, services and stuff are a little bit behind. So I think experience designers, in the same way that a lot of technologists are now volunteering to work for the government, take huge pay cut, volunteer to work for a little bit. This is a big thing in America right now. You get people from the valley coming in and helping the government. I think the same thing is true of experience designers. They should sharpen their craft in the private world because that's where the energy is, and then they should spend some of their time designing a better subway signage system or something. Oh my God, the fucking F train!
We've got this My Health Record thing you could do here if you want to hang around for a bit.
Yeah, I can do some of that.
That's our time. But what a fantastic set of thoughts! Please thank Nick Law.
Thank you.